for this session is improving the ETO process by using Solid Edge. And I'll make a disclaimer to start with. It's not a deep dive into the technical details of what we do in Solid Edge. It's more a business case and some of the reasons why we needed a better solution to help take out some of the margin for error and the long lead time for the front end on an ETO engineered to order product. So I'll talk a little bit about the business case, the business itself, and what caused the need for something like this. First of all, a little bit about the company profile. This page, there's a lot of things crammed on here, but you might recognize a couple of different brand names. You can see that there's reference to Bettis, Dantork, Schaefer. All of these are Emerson products, and it's one business unit within Emerson. And that business unit was comprised of a lot of different historically independently operating companies. And so you can imagine in that environment when you have a lot of different ways of managing your data, a lot of different engineering processes that are handled at different locations, and now all of them coming together, kind of trying to work as one family. There's a lot of conflict, a lot of opportunities for improvement. And it was through a lot of different acquisitions that these brand names have been kind of lumped together under Emerson. And the business unit is valve automation. The industry is oil and gas industry, mainly valve actuators and controls for natural gas and oil transmission, and also on oil platforms. So a lot of pipelines, compressor stations. Some of the actuators, you can see there's an electric actuator offering up in the top left. Some of those are used in the food industry. But primarily the market is the oil and gas companies. Various size valves from small valves into large valves. The portion that really, where it gets into the ETO or engineer to order portion is in the control systems. It's highlighted a little bit on the top right. It just is a blurb about control systems. But these are primarily engineered to order based on customer specifications. And the way that process works, inside sales will develop, or not develop, but identify a schematic, perhaps an existing schematic or a similar schematic, and that function is sold to the customer. But as you can see, there's a variety of different actuators. There's a variety of different components that are used oftentimes to perform the same functionality. And then to add a layer of complexity to that, there are specific customer requirements for instance, voltages, different environments, different electrical certifications that are required, material requirements. And so all of these things add variables into the configuration and make that engineer to order process even more difficult. Now, it's true in all of these cases, standardization is done as much as possible. For instance, the standard shape, style, and design of the actuator might be similar from a small actuator to a large actuator. I mentioned, you know, the valves, the pipelines go from, you know, anywhere from like a 4-inch valve up to a 36-inch valve. So obviously the different torque requirements require a larger actuator, more torque output. But the logic to open a 12-inch valve might be the same logic to open a 36-inch valve. The actuator itself is a different size, so that's a layer of variability. So a lot of times the customers will specify some very, very unique requirements. I mentioned the sales people might sell a schematic or a similar schematic and mark it up with the customer-specific requirements. And it could be one small requirement that really changes the whole design of the product. So that's some of the challenges that were faced by the engineering group. And to be competitive, obviously, one of the challenges is to reduce that front end lead time. Obviously, you're here because of the topic must have been of some interest, the ETO process. I don't know how many here are in that type of industry where you're kind of engineering to order based on a customer. I know you are because you work for the same company. So that's kind of the challenge that engineering faced. And as I mentioned, since each job might have specific requirements, a change at the last minute or an error, something that was missed by the engineer, that could really have a dramatic impact on the delivery, which obviously, you know, then has to be communicated to the customer, and they're not too happy about that. This is just a little background about myself and my role with Emerson. I'm the CAD admin for our business unit. So there are multiple locations globally. We have facilities in a couple in India, China, Dubai, Europe, and South America, Canada, Houston, and Mansfield right now. So all those different brands that I talked about, all of their different legacy engineering processes, all of their different legacy engineering, not only just part numbers, item numbers, data management tools, all of those things have kind of been brought together recently. So the a project that was just wrapped up this year was to migrate the legacy engineering data from all of those different locations into Teamcenter, which some of you may be familiar with being here with associated with Siemens. Teamcenter is the data management tool for right now we're using it for CAD vaulting. So I want to preface, as I mentioned, the presentation, as it's not a deep dive into the technical details, but right now we're developing a roadmap on how we can use Teamcenter even more for the type of process I'm going to talk about. So that's kind of the position that we're in. So today what we'll talk about is the ETO process I referred to a little bit, the challenge that we faced with some of the engineers. And the presentation talks about how the process can be improved, specifically if there's no direct interface between your engineering data management tool and your ERP system. In valve automation, as in a lot of Emerson business units, the ERP of choice is Oracle. So we have a manufacturing bill of material in Oracle, and we have engineers creating engineer-to-order products and assemblies in Solid Edge and Teamcenter, but they're not talking right now. In the future, you know, we want them to talk, and we're developing that roadmap, but our current state, it just doesn't exist. And so the challenge then became, how do you get that bill of material that you engineer in Solid Edge in 3D and migrate it into Oracle with as few of mistakes and as complete as possible? And that obviously posed a real challenge. One of the challenges also that is helped by this process is learning curve from new engineers. For the products that I talked about, for most of them, learning the control systems, the learning curve's not just a week or a couple weeks or months. It's at least a year for the new engineers to kind of see some of the different variations that might come up, the different configurations. You know, we might build the same configuration next week. We might not build it again for 5 or 10 years. So they might see something they've never seen before. And before using Solid Edge, in a lot of cases, they were using AutoCAD or another 2D product to generate like an outline drawing. And then the engineer still had to prepare the bill of materials. So the engineer would prepare the parts list. Essentially, that became the MBOM. And different methods for that. So in some of the facilities, the engineers directly imported that bill of material themselves, and sometimes they had data entry doing it. But all of that adds kind of another layer of an opportunity for an error. So we'll talk about how we got around that, and also talk about how we were able to use skin copies in Solid Edge to help lighten up the assemblies and be able to use those in a way that facilitates creating the MBOM from the Solid Edge assembly. So this is a little bit about the legacy process. They would the engineer would first of all, through historic records, find a similar order, one that was 90% close to, or 90% the same as the order that they were working on. And then they would print a bill of material, perhaps to Excel, perhaps they would actually even print it out as a hard copy, manipulate the bill of material markup. You know, they need this item in place of that one. Maybe it's a different pressure, so they need a different regulator. So they would go, source the regulator, identify that, add it to their bill of material. And again, they're working kind of outside of Oracle. They're working outside of Solid Edge to do this. It seems very archaic, but, unfortunately, because of the type of business and the legacy that they had, that was the process. And then that bill of material would manually be entered into the ERP system, even after using Oracle. And there's a screenshot coming up towards the end that shows the Oracle bill of material interface. So it was one of two things. They would either themselves enter those part numbers with the quantities, or they would give it to a data entry person. And obviously that introduces a lot of opportunity for error, especially considering the complexity of the product. Some of the bills of material had one, or a lot of them had 100 or more components that ended up on the MBOM. And that, that involved hardware items, tube fittings, and so the engineer, if it's up to them to remember, all of these components, and then throw in the aspect that in some cases perhaps it's a special material for a bolt, that is not, maybe it's 316 bolt that's not stocked, and if they miss a couple of bolts, it could actually have an impact on the lead time. So it represented a lot of manual effort, increased opportunity for error. And as I mentioned, it was up to the engineers then to rely a lot of times on their memory to say, oh, if I'm changing from this component to another component, I need special adaption components. And sometimes they're focused on the main components and would lose sight of those smaller ones. So it wasn't something the initial, I'll say, process for using Solid Edge to generate the MBOM was not something that we jumped into. There was a lot of legwork on the front end to first of all identify what are the main components, the standard components, and how do we want to structure them, because we wanted to make it as easily to configure as possible. The pictures on the left, I don't know how well they show up on the screen. They're kind of dark. But this is one of the actuators, and then this is the bottom of the actuator. And it's not really shown very well, but there are some dimensions here, dimension of cutout. That's kind of, I'll say, the base component, and all of everything else is built on that or added to it. So there's multiple sizes for that. So first engineering went through and created skin copies for these components, and it made the assembly lighter. And when they were all modeled in the same way, as you guys know, with the same planes, with the same reference planes and the same orientation, makes it much easier to replace components, to drop in the assembly. So all of that aided in making the Solid Edge assembly easier to configure. On the right-hand side, it's just a couple of other of the the components that I'll say are standard components. You'll see them in the assembly coming up, but they're proprietary components also. So some of the benefits also in creating a lot of the components as skin copies was that these assemblies could then be sent as step files to the customer without fear of the customer stealing any of the proprietary data. So all that took, I'll say, probably with a focused effort, between 6 months, a little over 6 months, and obviously it was in parallel to the normal production schedule. And we kind of started with, I'll say we didn't turn everyone loose. We started with a couple assemblies and set the standards on those assemblies, and then those assemblies became used as reference for the others. But I pointed out the cutout on the bottom because that was something that the cutout was actually added to the skin copy. So the skin copy was created from the assembly, and then the cutout was added. And this way, the engineers could use the same skin copy and just modify the part that did change from assembly to assembly, and that's the cutout, because it's valve specific to marry up to a specific valve manufacturer, valve size, valve stem, and so forth. So all that legwork took a little bit of time. Also, to identify which property in solid edge was going to be used as the part number, because we're generating the MBOM from the solid edge assembly. And probably, as you know, also the MBOM number may be different from the EBOM number in some cases. So you have an engineer that creates a perhaps even an adjustable assembly in some cases, or maybe they have a solenoid with a different voltage. In some cases, the engineering bill of material number might be different than the actual manufacturing bill of material number. And so a property had to be identified to be used as the property that would be exported to generate the bill of material. In this case, historically, for one site in valve automation, they used this property highlighted the part number, and that's in the file properties in the part. Since the introduction of Teamcenter, when all the parts were migrated to Teamcenter, that property was mapped to a specific property in Teamcenter called Oracle Part Number. So now all of the different engineering groups, when they enter a new item in Teamcenter, they can give it the MBOM number. There's a property for the MBOM number that they can use to export. And highlighted here, you can see it's an example of where this is the skin copy. And so it's saved in solid edge as underscore part, so that the engineer knows the difference between the skin copy and the assembly when they look for it. But when we export that, obviously we want it to have the Oracle part number, which is highlighted in the bottom right, which is the VA64100 number. And so each, as I mentioned, all of the components required for the MBOM are then added to the assembly. And, you know, there obviously could be an argument against that, you know, that makes for a more robust assembly, a heavier assembly, larger file. But again, you know, this is an engineered-to-order process. And so the key requirement in this case was to capture all of the components to make sure that there were fewer errors and they wouldn't have to try to procure those components late in the process and jeopardize the delivery of the product. So you can see in this assembly there's tubing. I don't know if you can recognize, and it's kind of hard to see. This is one of the standard components, as well as this, the two that I showed. And then this is the base, the actuator that actually turns the valve, and everything else gets bolted onto it. And so each of those components has a property or utilizes the file property part number that matches up to the Oracle MBOM number. And then within the assembly itself, the structure was set up. This shows grouped, and then one of the groups expanded. As an example, there's actually two groups expanded here. If you look at the valve adaption components and the GHT components, these are components that are all grouped together or kind of a specific part of the assembly. For instance, the valve adaption components, that represents all of the components that are designed specifically for the actuator to mount to customer-specific valve. So there are a number of different valve manufacturers. They all have their different top works or stem dimensions. And the actuator is designed to mount directly onto it. There's an interface flange that mounts onto it. All of this, again, it's ETO components. But those valve adaption components are the components required to mate the actuator assembly to the valve. So all of those, including the hardware, are grouped together. I mentioned how that can be used as a learning aid for some of the engineers. You know, they can see how the adaption was designed if they want to look at that specific group of components. And then, you know, likewise with whatever requirements there are, you know, I expanded the GHT, that's the tanks, all the components, including the hardware. There's diffusers in the top, reducers in the bottom, all of those are kind of grouped together. And also it can be used to, as we'll see, it's the same structure that's used on the MBOM bill of material. And it can even be set up, in some cases it was set up to facilitate, you know, in the stockroom grouping of components, because it's not an automated stockroom. There's still people that go out and get the components for most of the sites. And so these can be grouped together in a way that, you know, it makes it easier for the stockroom to go out and grab the parts that are together. So whatever, you know, whatever type of logic that kind of makes sense for the specific ETO process. And also, obviously, you can see it's less clutter on the navigation pane, or it's easier to move around as if you expand one group at a time. This is just another example of how it was used kind of as a learning aid for some of the new engineers. There's three tubes that are highlighted in green. And in this case, I don't know if anyone uses frames or tubing. Historically, these groups have used the tubing to create their tube runs. Most recently, they've started using frames, because the frame, actually, to create the frame, they bring in a part. It's actually, they create a part in Solid Edge, and it's saved in Teamcenter. And associated with that part are properties. For instance, if tubing is called out on your bill of material, you can assign your manufacturing part number to that tube part. You bring it in, and it still utilizes your paths. When you create a tube run path, you can bring in that part and generate using frames. In this case, it's all of the quarter inch tubing that goes to the top of the tanks. So rather than creating a new solid edge part for every tube run, then using the frames, they're able to use that one standard part. Does that make sense? Kind of. And then the additional benefit, they kind of group it together so that, as I mentioned, those green tubes are all of the tubes that's the incoming power. So they put it in the same sequence as the flow of the schematic diagram. So if you follow those frames step by step, it kind of takes you through the circuit in the actual physical components. So it's helpful for, again, for some of the new engineers with the learning curve. They can see, you know, the gas comes in the top of the actuator, and then the next step, these are actually gas over oil actuators. So then the oil will get pressurized, and the oil flows out the bottom of the tanks and goes to the next component. So in that way, they've kind of used it as a learning aid for some of the new engineers. And this is just a parts list. It's nothing fancy. The next part is of the process is pretty pretty simple. I mean, it's I feel kind of silly presenting copy and paste, but essentially that's all it is. They generate a parts list, but the benefit of this parts list is kind of all of the work that went in up front, because all of the grouping of the components, creating the skin copies, all of that activity kind of sets it up so that when you create the parts list, it's in the sequence and in the grouping that you want for your MBOM. So the parts list is just, it's added to the background sheet or to the outside the title block. And I took a little screenshot of the title block in there, because this bill of material, again, it's used to generate the MBOM, but it's not the master MBOM. As soon as the MBOM is created, since there is no connection between Oracle and Solid Edge, then, you know, the MBOM in Oracle becomes the master. And if you keep it here, it's out of date automatically. Now, it doesn't mean you can't keep it there, but that's just the decision that they made. If they ever need to make a bill of material change, they're going to change the assembly, and they're also going to change the bill of material in Oracle. So if there is a revision, they have to do it both places in the future. They're always making sure that they match. Yes? That's a good question. I have a screenshot in here about that. But they struggled with that at first, because they tried to restructure and leave out balloon numbers in the draft, and it did not renumber the way that they expected it, and they had a lot of difficulty with that. Is that kind of what you're getting at? Right. Right. Yeah. And in this case, they don't balloon the drawing. So that's how they get away with it. So if you look at the drawing itself, there's no balloon items because it would have, you know, like 100 balloon items or more. And the draft that they're generating from this process is the draft file that goes to the customer. It's a general outline drawing. For some of the lower level assemblies, and I guess I should have probably explained that. This is for the very top level customer assembly drawing that's getting generated. For the sub-assemblies, they will place the parts list with the balloons and use whatever structure Solid Edge uses to generate the bill of material that gets loaded to Oracle. So this is, I should have prefaced with that, sorry. But that's how they get around it. Yeah, sure. So they just they place the parts list, and as I mentioned, and it's structured. The idea is to get it the grouping the way they want it, and then just a copy and paste. Well, before they copy and paste, you know, you can go into the parts list properties and add columns. One of the columns that's added is that property that I mentioned was identified that was going to be used as the MBOM number, the part number. So they add that column, and they add the, you know, remove whatever columns they don't want, like title and even file name, because the file name in a lot of cases is different than the part number. All they're after is getting that MBOM number. So they kind of structure that parts list on the draft, and then copy and paste. And I didn't share the name of the data loader that's used. I don't know... There's a lot of different data loaders. This has happened to be one that they use, and I didn't want to share their information without talking to them. But they copy it and paste into an Excel, and this is where they can renumber it. It's easier to renumber in Excel, so they just give it whatever standard bill of material sequence that they want to use for the customer assembly, and then copy it into this data loader. And you can see, it has the sequence number first in the first column, and then a tab, and then that VAED number is the actual MBOM number, and then tabs again, then it enters the quantity, the star DN goes down to the next line, and that makes more sense when we see this. So this is the way the ERP system bill of material is structured. So they enter the item number, it tabs, and tabs again, and enters the MBOM number, tabs again, and this is automatically populated and it enters a quantity and goes down the line and just uploads the bill of material into the ERP system. And as archaic as it sounds, before this process, for a lot of the groups, they were doing this manually or having a data entry person do it manually. It always was a struggle with the product because we wanted to be as standardized as much as possible, but we were limited given, you know, the product itself and the customer requirements, just the sheer number of variations that were available. So again, this is, you know, it's not a recommended process, I'll say, for somebody that's making, you know, 1,000 of the same component, you know, every day or every week. It's definitely geared towards an engineered order process, and in lieu of having, you know, direct connection or direct interface with your Oracle ERP system or whatever ERP system you're using. And just a quick slide to talk about a couple of benefits. One of the goals was to improve accuracy, and I talked to the engineering manager this week, and they actually log errors, number of errors, continually trying to improve the process and identify what are the reasons why we miss, you know, customer requirements for ship dates. There's been a lot of good improvements in that regard, but through all the matrix that he's tracked, he's seen a 12% accuracy on the first pass. And it sounds like a lot. You're like, I mean, you guys must have sucked before. But again, it's a 100-plus item bill of material. And if there's one bolt, it's a quarter-inch bolt that's not on the bill of material, they would get dinged for it. So that involved tube fittings. You know, if you had a tube fitting that went into a quarter-inch MPT port and had a 3/8 tube, you know, and they called out a quarter-quarter fitting, it was an error. So now, by using the assembly to generate the MBOM, if you use that fitting and you do your tube run, you can obviously see if the tube is too big, if it's going into the fitting, or it's too small. It helps visually the engineer see and make sure that they have the correct size bolt or tube fitting. Those were actually the main cause of errors, and it doesn't sound like a big deal, but as I mentioned, because of the specific customer requirements, a lot of times they had special components, special tube fittings. Even we've had tube fittings that are several week lead time because of Manel material instead of standard stainless. So those things are kind of what would throw a wrench in at the end of the process when they're getting ready to final assembly. So that's pretty much it. That's what I had to share. Obviously, you can ask any questions. Offer recommendations. It's funny you ask that. One of my objectives this year is to investigate that. But where we are kind of in our evolution as a business unit, as I mentioned, through all the various acquisitions, our first step was to kind of get everybody under the same PLM and improve the process as much as possible based on where we are right now, and then continue to improve on that. So I don't know a lot about it, I'll be honest. Is there something you see that would you think would help out a lot? Or even a little. Yeah, as I mentioned, that's one of my objectives for this year. I just started in my current position about a year ago, and actually picked up the project in the middle to migrate all of our data that was located in all these global locations into a central global data center. And that's been our focus this past year, and it just wrapped up in September. So this year we're going to focus on what we can do along those lines. So, yeah. And again, there are some. Mike's here. He's from Emerson also, same business unit, and he works with a different product brand than the brand that I demonstrated here, and they have a configurator in Oracle, which. They have a slightly different process. So not all of the groups are even using this process. I'll say probably 50% of them are right now. And again, it's kind of the stepping stone to get engineers used to that connection, working with, you have an MBOM and an EBOM, and getting that used to having the solid edge and team center, kind of that thinking that goes from there into pushed into ERP. Yes? we're using a SolidEdge ST6 right now. And that's a whole nother story. Mike just updated from V20 to ST6. There is a plan to go to, there is a plan to update. So now, again, as I mentioned, all of these, we kind of had these different companies operating almost independently at different locations, and he was on an Insight server. And before his data was moved into the global data center, they were saying, okay, we're not gonna spend any more money to update the server because that server is gonna go away. So just use that now, but they couldn't update versions because they were on Insight. It wouldn't support a newer version of SolidEdge. And so everybody, since we're all in the global data center, all of the groups have to be on the same version. The first group that went live with Teamcenter used ST6. So they were stuck until everybody else got on. Okay, go ahead. Which part? In same database? Okay. Okay. So we do have thanks for that, because that's not what I understood. Right. And I guess and that makes sense, and I guess maybe that's probably more what I was alluding to. And the reason is some of the products, the actuators, they share controls, so the part of the benefit of getting everybody into the global data center was that someone from a group in India can use Mike's actuator and put their controls on it. He owns the design of the actuator, but they can use it as read-only in their assembly. But to answer your first question, we are planning an update to ST8 in the next couple of months. We're on version 10.1.0 of Teamcenter, so we have to do a new patch to Teamcenter before we can update versions of SolidEdge. To my understanding, we're bumping up to 10.1.3, I believe. The way we're kind of set up with our business unit, we're hosted with corporate on their data center. And so they actually own our Teamcenter licenses, and they are the admins for the Teamcenter database, because the servers are in St. Louis. And so we coordinate with them, but then the SolidEdge versions are all managed locally by the local IT in the various world areas. So, and again, like I mentioned, I've been doing this for about a year, so there's a lot of things that I've learned, a lot of things that I have yet to learn and find out about how things are set up. So, I appreciate any of the feedback, definitely. We have about 120 engineers and 400 viewers in Teamcenter. So not a lot, but enough to keep you busy. Yes, both. I consider engineers. Yeah. They have author permissions in Teamcenter. Yeah. I don't believe I understood the question. I'm sorry. So obviously, probably no. Okay. we have looked at that. We had a presentation with our global VPs of IT and engineering last year, and again, that's one of my objectives to investigate these different options for that we have going forward. So yeah, that was definitely one that we had looked at. Thank you.